Good evening. Excuse me. Good evening. This is Pastor Bob Quaintance, Good Hope Lutheran Church in Youngstown, Ohio, or more correctly, Boardman, Ohio. Greetings. The Lord is with you. Tonight, we're going to be looking at Matthew chapter 11 as we journey through the New Testament during this year. And it's been quite a wonderful journey already, and I am so thrilled with what we've accomplished, getting through the Gospel of Mark, the Book of Acts, the Book of Hebrews, Galatians, James, and now back into our second Gospel, the first one written, or the first one in order in our Bible, the Gospel of St. Matthew, or the Gospel according to St. Matthew. 7 o'clock and time for Thursday evening devotion. I should be on tomorrow, although it's my day off, and I'm not sure it'll be exactly at 7 o'clock, but we'll see what's going on with my family. So let's start as we do every night by making the sign of the cross and saying together, we are under the care of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And I invite us to pray at this time. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word and just bursting out of the scriptures comes your wonderful promises. And thank you for the promise that comes bursting out today in chapter 11. Lord, we pray that you would help us to follow that gracious invitation. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we are in the initial opening chapters, setting the stage for Jesus in chapters 1 through 3. Then we come to these five great narrative sections where there's, at the end of each one, there's a major teaching of Jesus. We've already looked at the first section, chapters 4 through 7, the second chapters we ended yesterday, 8 through 10. And today, in 11 through 13, we look at the third section. And the unique thing about this third section, the last week, the second section was about Jesus bringing the kingdom of God into people's lives. This time, we're going to see responses to Jesus. And they're quite varied. Some people have a positive response. He is the Messiah. Some aren't sure. Is he the Messiah? And then there's like the Pharisees and scribes. There's the negative response. He is absolutely not the Messiah. He must be of the devil. Jesus will end this section in chapter 13 with another major teaching, but this is a number of little teachings of parables. So today we're in chapter 11, Friday we'll be in chapter 12, and then we're going to be encountering all these various responses to Jesus, and then we're going to get on Monday to the parables of the kingdom. I can't wait. I'm looking forward to our time in the Word in these days. So let me put a couple of notes away and just open up to the Bible and get into our teaching. Good evening, Shirley and Mark. Glad that you're on tonight. Chapter 11. So again, we're going to be finding various responses. And the first one comes as a kind of unsure about who Jesus is. Earlier, he was very sure, but his circumstances have changed, and so he's unsure. You know, sometimes we can be harsh on people because they move from faith to doubt. We do not see Jesus being harsh with someone who's become unsure, especially because of his circumstances. But we just don't see Jesus being harsh. In fact, he's quite gracious. And the person we're speaking about is John the Baptist. Chapter 11 begins with the phrase that ends all of the five great teachings. When Jesus had finished instructing or saying these things or giving these parables, but it always starts when Jesus had finished. That tells us the previous section is now over, and we're beginning a new section in Matthew's gospel. When he had finished instructing the 12 disciples, he went on from there to teach and preach in their cities. Here he goes. Well, we've always heard him preaching, teaching, and healing, and here the focus is mostly on his preaching and teaching, not on the healing. And again, I am just struck all the time with how Jesus, John the Baptist as well, the disciples are sent out to be people of the word, people who's speaking the word, has the ability to change people's lives. And he's going to do that with John. Well, he went on from there to teach and preach from the mountain that he was sitting on and the area he was teaching at. He went on. And now, when John the Baptist heard in prison, of course, he'd been arrested, not yet killed, that's coming up. But when John heard in prison about the deeds of the Christ, he heard about all that Jesus was doing. His disciples were watching Jesus and telling him about Jesus. He sent word by his disciples and said to him, to Jesus, "Are you the one who is to come, or shall we look for another?" John had pointed people to Jesus, had said that he was not worthy to baptize Jesus, but that he needed to be baptized by him. He was so sure then. But now he's got a question. Are you really the Messiah? It's as though John the Baptist, I think, has staked his whole life. He's gone out away from people living in the wilderness, wearing camel's clothes and eating locusts and wild honey. His whole life has been dedicated to God and to introducing and pointing out the coming Messiah. Well, he wants to make sure he hasn't wasted his life. It's a big question. You know, the thing about doubt is nobody doubts little things. I don't doubt. I've often said whether or not I can afford a pack of gum, I just reach in my pocket and see if I got a buck or two. I don't worry about it. I don't doubt about buying a pack of gum. But the big issues, we're selling our house to our son and going to be building a house. And do we have enough money? How much money would be the right amount of money? Oh, I'm a little unsure. It's the big issues that always make us unsure. And this is the biggest issue of all for John the Baptist. Has he invested his life poorly or wisely? His whole life invested in introducing the Messiah. And so he comes with this most sincere question that you find in Scripture. Are you the one who is to come, or shall we look for another? Wow. So Jesus responds, "Hey, buck it up, John. Get a grip on it." No. We welcome one another in our times of doubt. It probably means we're struggling. John's in prison. Life circumstances are there. But also, this is a big deal. And in this moment of deep struggle, as he looks at his whole life and how he has focused on introducing the Messiah, he wants to make sure he's right. Well, does living for Jesus really matter for you? Is tithing, giving our 10% and offerings, really been worth it? Or have I just been wasting my money? St. Paul says, if for this life only we have believed in Christ, we are most to be pitied. You bet wrong, and you should have gone out and spent the money partying. That's what Paul would say. But we aren't wrong. Jesus is risen. And it changes everything. Good evening, Ray. So Jesus answered the disciples of John, "Go and tell John." He knows his name. He knows yours when you're doubting. "Go and tell John what you hear and see. He doesn't answer the question. Oh, yes, I'm the one. That wouldn't have been of any help. Not deeply. And it wouldn't really matter what Jesus said. What matters is his life in alignment with Scripture. Go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk. Lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up, and the poor have good news preached to them. And blessed is the one who is not offended by me. Jesus is referring John back, as John well knows, to the prophet Isaiah. From chapter 29 through chapter 61, my study Bible offers many passages of Scripture. The blind receive sight, Isaiah 29 and 35. The lame walk, Isaiah 35. Lepers cured, Isaiah 53. The deaf hear, Isaiah 29 and 35. The dead are raised, Isaiah 26. The poor have good news preached, Isaiah 61. I'm glad for the study notes where you can go back and you just find the references where all those things are. His life, his ministry, the fruit of his ministry, the fruit of righteousness, the fruit of his ministry bears evidence. Don't ask Jesus, are you really the one? Oh, yeah, I'm the one. No, no. He points John back to the fruit of his life, what is happening. And it is exactly in accord with what Isaiah says the Messiah will be doing. So, find my place here. As they went away, the disciples of John, as they went back to report to John, and I'm sure, the scriptures don't tell us every story, but I am sure that John was satisfied. That what Jesus did is he preached the word to John. The great preacher, Jesus preaches the word, just reminds him of the story. And John goes, ah, yeah, I remember. Remember just Easter, the women had forgotten and thought the tomb would be closed. And the angel said to them, remember what he said to you while he was still in Galilee, that the Son of Man must suffer and be rejected and be killed and on the third day rise again. He is not here. He is risen. Oh, and they remembered his words. But Jesus has pointed John back to the word. I have absolute confidence that the word did its work in John's life, and he settled down. What a gift to John at the end of his life to know that he had pointed to Jesus correctly. Good evening, Katie. So as they went away, Jesus began to speak to the crowds concerning John, asking, what did you go in the wilderness to see? Were you just out to see nature? A reed shaken by the wind? What then did you go out to see? Did you go to see somebody dressed in fine clothes? Well, not John. People, behold, those who wear soft clothing are in kings' houses. What then did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is he of whom it is written. Here's a quote from Malachi chapter 3, verse 1. Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before me. John had a question about Jesus. Are you the one who is to come, or shall we look for another? Jesus' word, I think, answers that question for John. But Jesus has no question about John. He knows exactly who he is. He knows his strengths. He knows his strengths even when John feels weak. God bless Jesus' word. He lifts up John in front of them, more than a prophet. He's the one who was written by Malachi. Truly, and then this word, truly I tell you, among those born of women, in other words, every human being, there has arisen no one greater than John the Baptist. Not Moses, not Abraham. Well, I don't know, at least not the prophets. But Jesus says no one greater. Is he exaggerating? I don't know. No one greater, because not even Abraham got to introduce the Messiah, not King David, not even Moses, although they all pointed towards the Messiah. Here, John is given the privilege of introducing the Messiah. Wow. Those born of women, there's not arisen anyone greater than John. Yet, the one who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. Those born of women, everybody, no one's greater than John. But those who are least in the kingdom, they have been born of the Spirit. John chapter 3, born of God. Those who have been baptized and believe, those who are following Jesus, well, the least of them is greater than John. So great is the difference between the old covenant and the new covenant that Jesus brings, that even the least in the kingdom of God is greater than John. Well, let's not get too proud of ourselves, huh? From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. Well, John's been violently treated by Herod. The kingdom is opposed. And we'll see in these chapters 11 and 12 that Jesus and the kingdom of heaven are opposed. For all the prophets and law, Moses and all the prophets, prophesied until John. And if you are willing to accept it, he is Elijah to come. Malachi chapter 4, verse 5. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. But to what shall I compare this generation? John had some questions about Jesus. Jesus had some thoughts, glorious thoughts about John. But now he turns to the generation around him. You could say as us as well. To what shall I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplace and calling to their playmates. We played the flute for you and you did not dance. We sang a dirge and you did not mourn. The children want to be in control of telling others what they're supposed to do. They want to be like adults. They want to make the decisions. They want to tell people what to do and have people do it. But Jesus does not conform to the expectations of his generation. I think that's partly what tripped up John. But Jesus straightens him out by pointing him back to the Word. Jesus does not conform to the ideas. And that's why often he tells people in the Gospels not to tell anybody about him. Because they have if they say he's the Messiah, well, he's not the Messiah they're thinking about. And to show how people have this idea about Jesus, that he does not follow their patterns, which he doesn't, he then says, for John came neither eating nor drinking. And they said, he has a demon. Who wouldn't want to eat and drink? The Son of Man, on the other hand, came eating and drinking, and they say, look at him, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. You can't please all the people all the time. And there's some people you will never please. Well, that's this generation, including the scribes and the Pharisees. Jesus ends up verse 19 by saying, wisdom is justified by her deeds. You can look at the life of John the Baptist and you can look at the life of Jesus and you see their fruits. Again, the blind see, the lame walk, lepers are cleansed, deaf hear, the dead are raised up, and the poor have good news preached to them. Wisdom is justified by her deeds. Look at the results of the impact of the fruit that is born, or the impact of the lives of those who are the opposition to Jesus. And compare it to what Jesus does. Compare it to what Jesus does for you. On Good Friday, we were talking about Jesus, the offering of Jesus, the offering. And by that one single offering, there are no more sacrifices, no more offering for sin. For one time, he has paid the penalty for all sin, for all sinners, for all of time. But we also talked about our offering, and the person who was being interviewed talked about they just can't outgive God. God has always been so good to them. And so, although it's challenging at times, they tithe and they have opened themselves to trusting God, and they've never found God to be unworthy of that trust. He's always provided in amazing ways. They haven't become rich, but that's not the goal of a Christian. But God has provided for all their needs. Wisdom is justified by her deeds. Look at a person who's just tried to put God first in their life, and God has blessed them. Well, so he does with us. Jesus says, wisdom is justified by our deeds. Look at the fruit of those who are in opposition. And look at what Jesus does. Who do you want to follow? Then Jesus looks at the cities where he's gotten most of his opposition. He began to denounce the cities where most of his mighty works had done because they did not repent. Woe to you, Chorazin. We've never heard about his trip there. Interesting. Woe to you, Bethsaida. We've heard of Jesus going there. For if the mighty works done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon long ago, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I tell you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for Tyre and Sidon than for you. Again, this is that comment about the Old Testament, or the days before the coming of the Messiah, and John the Baptist born of women, no one greater, and the least in the kingdom. We're having that kind of conversation that back then, they didn't have Jesus. They didn't have John the Baptist introducing Jesus. And if they had, they'd have repented long before Chorazin or Bethsaida. And then his home base of operations at Capernaum. Jesus says, and you, Capernaum, will you be exalted to heaven? You will be brought down to Hades. For if the mighty works done in you had been done in Sodom, just think of that one day where he went and healed Simon's mother-in-law. And then after that, people came from all over the city bringing demon-possessed people, and he cast the demons out, all of them, and he healed every person of every disease that came to him. If the deeds done in you, Capernaum, had been done in Sodom, it would have remained until this day. You remember the story of Sodom and Gomorrah destroyed by God with fire and brimstone. Well, if Jesus had done there what he'd done in Capernaum, they would have repented long ago. And it would remain until this day. But I tell you, it would be more tolerable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom than for you. Isn't that interesting? The mighty works of Jesus being done in Chorazin, Bethsaida, and Capernaum. And not everybody is coming to faith. They aren't repenting. Woe to you because you do not repent. You do not turn from your evil and turn to trust in God. Good evening, Mary Beth. I see you're on as well. Well, then we come. We've seen this unsureness about John. And then we've seen the opposition to Jesus. We're going to get various responses to Jesus. Some following him, some believing he's the Messiah, some unsure, and some in opposition. Well, but then, right in the middle of this, at the end of chapter 11, and as we then go into chapter 12, well, we get this promise just bursting out of the scripture, a favorite one of so many people. What a blessing we get today. So, verse 25, a prayer of Jesus's. After that time, Jesus declared, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. How do people come to faith? It must be revealed by God. The words that Jesus speaks are like seed cast on the ground for everyone. Some seed is ground that, some people like ground that opens the seed, receives it, and it bears fruit. And other people are just like hard soil, and it never penetrates or it gets choked out. How do you explain that? Well, Jesus says the Father has hidden this from the wise and understanding and opened it to little children who are more concerned about trusting than understanding, than controlling, like the flute player and the singing of the dirge that we heard about earlier. They just will trust in the Father's word. Jesus says this prayer, "Thank you, Father, that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Thank you, Father, that you've moved in the hearts of children, people not full of themselves." Certainly that would include John the Baptist, who came with his doubts to Jesus and was well received and well regarded. Don't ever worry about coming to Jesus with your doubts. Verse 27, "All these things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father. And no one knows the Father God except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him." You can know God through Jesus Christ, who reveals the Father in his life, teaching, miracles, power, authority, death, and resurrection. Pray for your friends who don't know Jesus. Then tell them about Jesus. Pray that God would open their hearts, that Jesus would reveal himself to your friends. Pray for the Lord of the harvest to send out harvester or workers into the harvest. That was what he said just before his last great teaching. And then this promise. What a way to end tonight's devotion. "Come to me," just like John the Baptist did at the beginning of the chapter. "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden." He won't shoot you. He won't condemn you, even if the heavy burden are doubts. That is not Jesus. What a God we have. "Come to me." People love this passage. Matthew chapter 11, 28 to 30. Man, we ought to just always know that. This is a memory verses. "Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest," Sabbath. "Take my yoke upon you. When your labor is done, you'll be able to rest. He will give you rest from your labor. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you." You know what that is, of course, the yoke of oxen, the instrument that would tie together two cattle that are pulling a plow, two horses pulling a wagon. He invites us to be yoked to him. And in that case, we're not like two equal size oxen pulling me and Jesus, like I can help him out. No, I'm like the little 3-year-old following along dad who's out mowing the lawn and he has his play mower, not doing anything but helping dad. And dad loves it, right? Well, "Take my yoke upon you." He's going to pull the weight. "And learn from me." It is all about discipleship, all about following Jesus, being a learner, being an apprentice of Jesus, being a student of Jesus. Watch Jesus, like the little boy with his fake lawnmower. "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me." Watch me. Listen to me. And know this, like he was with John, he says to you, "I am gentle and lowly," or humble in heart. He's not going to be yelling at you. When you come to him, his arms will be wide open and he will take you and he will carry you always. You don't need to do anything, but one thing and one thing only. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. I think John the Baptist did, because, of course, Jesus lifted him up and preached the word to him. And now he's preaching the word to you. Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy burdened. Whatever the burden, whatever the concern is, whatever the weariness, you come to Jesus with it. Don't think you're bothering him. Come to Jesus. I'm thinking of a burden now I hadn't been thinking about. I'm going to take it to Jesus in prayer when we're done. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Now, he'll carry the weight. He'll pull the load. You just come to him and get connected to Christ, and he will carry the load. My yoke is easy, and my burden is light. What a glorious ending. In the midst of doubt and opposition, Jesus is inviting everybody to come to him. Well, hardly gets any better than that, but the gospel goes on. So it's wonderful. Tonight or tomorrow we'll be in chapter 12. Let's pray. Well, Lord, thank you for your treatment of John, and thank you for the word that I'm sure encouraged him and helped him to face the end of his life with the same kind of confidence he had in the middle of his life. Thank you, Lord, in the midst of opposition, you don't get nasty. You open your arms and invite us to come to you. And it won't be that we come to you because we figure it all out, not wise and understanding, but like children who simply trust in you. And that will be hard because life is hard. But you invite us to put our trust in you, to fear, love, and trust you above anything else, to come to you with any and all our burdens, and you will give rest for our souls. I pray for each person tonight, Lord, listening, or listening to this later, that, Lord, they can bring their issue, which I'm thinking about one right now, I need to turn over to you. Lord, whatever those things are in their life and in my life right now, Lord, we come to you with that burden. And we turn it over to you. Lord, help us to connect to your yoke and carry us. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, what a joy to be with you tonight and have this glorious passage. Joyce, good evening to you. I see you're on. Well, it's time for me to end, and I'll be with you tomorrow at some point, maybe about 7, but we'll see how my day off journeys. And I'll just end by saying, as I do every night, remember God loves you, and so do I. And what a passage to celebrate his love. Matthew 11, 28 to 30. Memorize it. Hide it in your heart. Have a great evening. Bye-bye.